come to you tonight in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, that we can come in the middle of our week, and Lord, we can position ourselves by faith in your presence. God, in your presence is everything that we have need of tonight. Lord, we just pray that you'll move in power, Lord God, that you will help us to grow in the word tonight. Help us, Lord God, to unload those heavy burdens that maybe we've been carrying already this week. God, just refresh us. God, just renew us in your presence tonight, we pray. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus.
Praise. Have your way in this place tonight, we pray. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, let's open our Bibles tonight to Acts chapter 8. And again, we've been looking at Acts chapter 8. And last time we were together, Sister Virgie did an incredible job last week. I got to listen to her teaching on the podcast on the way home. And I shared with her that I was blessed that she filled in and that she did such a great job. But last time we were together, we were talking about Simon the Sorcerer. And Simon the Sorcerer was trying to buy the power that the disciples were demonstrating. He was a sorcerer. That was his background. And he was trying to buy the ability. Oh, yeah, I've got packets. You want to see if anybody else needs one? I've got chapter 8 packets. If you don't have one, just put your hand up and Susan will help get you one of those. But Simon the Sorcerer wanted to have, he genuinely wanted to be saved, if you read the chapter. And I think he eventually did give his heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. But then he kind of got off track and wanted to buy the power that the disciples had, because he saw them laying hands on people and then people being healed and people being set free. And he wanted to buy that power. And that ended up being a very contentious thing, because that's not something you can purchase, is the power of God. We covered verses 1 through 13 of chapter 8. And so if you just got a packet, or if you have your old packets, we're on Peter and John's ministry. It's a little bit almost at the bottom of the page, verses 14 through 25. So if you want to turn to that page, Peter and John's ministry, verses 14 through 25 of Acts chapter 8. And let's go ahead and read that section, and then we'll jump into the packets tonight. And again, this is a time of teaching, so if you have a comment or a question, feel free to just slip your hand up, and we want the interaction. We encourage the interaction tonight. All right? Verse 14. Now, when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Verse 18, and when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whosoever I lay my hands, he may receive the Holy Spirit. But Peter said unto him, your money perish with you, because you have thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of this your wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you. For I perceive that you are in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. And then answered Simon and said, pray ye to the Lord for me, that none of these things that you have spoken come upon me. And they, when they had testified and preached the word of the Lord, returned to Jerusalem and preached the gospel in many villages of the Samaritans. What do we know from previous chapters in Acts about the Samaritans? What was significant about this gospel coming to the Samaritans? What do we know about their background?
The Jewish people didn't have anything to do with them. They were intermarried and they didn't want to be around them.
Right. They were despised, right? Yeah. Because the Jews had this, it may have even been self-righteousness or self-righteous pride, that they had not violated, even though they had. They hadn't violated the one part of the law that said they weren't to intermarry, but yet they had probably violated many other areas, right? But they held that against the Samaritans because the Samaritans intermarried. And it is true that when the Samaritans intermarried with some of the people that God told them they were not supposed to, they began to take on the customs and the false religions of these other places as well. And so the Samaritans were despised. So for the gospel to go from the Jews first, and then after they leave, you know, the day of Pentecost, they leave Jerusalem and go out with the gospel, for it to go to the Samaritans, there were some Jews that probably had some issues with that. Do they deserve the gospel? Much like for us, it's probably very difficult for us because of 9/11 or because of what's going on in Israel right now to think that the Arab people can receive the gospel. Because for us, there's a personal a connection there, right? But God came, the gospel is for whosoever will. And so he even goes to the Samaritans. He doesn't ask the Jews for permission, does he? God doesn't have to ask permission. And the gospel starts coming to the Samaritans, even the most despised people in the perspective of the Jews. And they begin to get saved. And their salvation is authentic. There's a change in their heart. And even not only just salvation, but then the Holy Spirit baptism that we read about in these verses is talking about the Holy Spirit. It doesn't say Holy Spirit baptism, but it says they received, in verse 15, they received the Holy Spirit. They'd only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. That was baptism in water, right? So they're talking about receiving the Holy Spirit just like they did on the day of Pentecost, which meant being baptized in the Holy Spirit, speaking in other tongues. So the Samaritans not only got saved, but they received the Holy Spirit just like the apostles did on the day of Pentecost in the book of Acts. And so that's what that passage is talking about. So let's pick up with our packets here in verses 14 through 25 there at the bottom of the page. Everybody on the same page? All right, Peter and John's ministry. The truth is that the baptism in the Holy Spirit is an experience separate from salvation. Two distinct works of grace. By grace through faith, we are saved and forgiven of our sins and given a hope of heaven. Jesus becomes our Savior and Lord. A separate, distinct work of grace is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And as we said on Sunday, it's God's desire that every believer receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and to be filled with the power and the person of the Holy Spirit so that we can walk in victory, so that we can have His power making up what we cannot do in our own strength. Amen? And I'm thankful for many of you that were filled or refilled Sunday morning. While the Holy Spirit is certainly involved in all that the believer receives from the Lord, still there is a great difference in being born of the Spirit than being baptized in the Spirit. When we're saved, we're born of the Spirit.
That's right.
There's a work of regeneration, which is a theological term. What that means is Jesus comes in, Isaiah chapter 1, and though our sins were as scarlet, what does He do? He makes them white as snow. That's regeneration. Him coming in and doing on the inside of us what we couldn't do by our determination, by trying to keep the law, by our own efforts. He did a work. We're born of the Spirit, and the Spirit comes inside, and He cleans us up. He makes us a place where, like Jesus says in Revelation 3:20, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will open the door, I will come in and eat with him, and he with me." How many know Jesus doesn't come into a dirty house? The Holy Spirit cleans our hearts up to where Jesus can feel at home in our hearts. And that's regeneration. But the regeneration happens at salvation. But a lot of people that believe that's all you get. Everything that you get of the Holy Spirit happens at salvation. As Pentecostals, we don't believe that. We believe there's more. There's always more that God wants to give us. And the second work of grace is the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And it's for whosoever will. All you have to do is be saved to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and then God can refill you, and He can use you in the gifts of the Spirit after you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit, which is to help edify and build up the church. And so these are all lessons. I know there's a lot of controversy with Phineas Dake. He had a Bible that he wrote. There's a lot of things that we don't agree with Dake, but he had a lot of things right, and so we'll reference him on a couple of things tonight. But he referenced that there's a difference between being born of the Spirit and being baptized in the Holy Spirit, and that they're two separate experiences for the believer. Prayer for the Holy Spirit. Did I skip a page? I think I skipped a page, didn't I?
Nope.
No, are we good? I'm on the right thing. Okay. So these are lessons outlined by Dave. Prayer for the Holy Spirit is part of the gospel program. All right? It gives some verses for that. And this is consistent in what we see in the apostles' practice in Acts chapter 8. They would get people saved, and they didn't wait 6 months, right? It's what the modern church does. We wait until, you know, we feel an appropriate time. They got people saved, and what do? They were looking for water. The moment they got saved, they're looking for water for them to be baptized. And then probably while they're bringing them up out of the water, they're actually thinking about, we need to pray for them to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They're not waiting 6 months. And I'm not saying that that everybody's always going to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit right after they get saved. Some people do have to be taught and have to process that. But we shouldn't prolong this second work of grace, amen, that God has for every believer. They need the power of the Holy Spirit as soon as possible. And different people are ready for that experience at different times, yes. But it's interesting that in the early church, it was very quick. They were seeing them saved and then saying, hey, let's lay hands on them to receive the Holy Spirit within days after their salvation. And so maybe some lessons for us in the modern church. The Holy Spirit here must refer to the Spirit baptism and the supernatural gifts of the Spirit for service, not to salvation, for these people were already saved from sin, justified, born again, healed, baptized in water, and had great joy in Christ. And again, if you read verses 15 through 17, it doesn't say Holy Spirit baptism, but in the language you can tell they're talking about two different experiences. They're talking about baptism for repentance, and then they're talking about the Holy Spirit coming on them outside of that in a second experience. It was evidently what the church at Jerusalem had received, so they wanted other churches to have it as well. And there's some references there. So they're, anywhere the gospel goes, they're preaching as well. Salvation through Jesus and what he did at the cross, but then also you need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The gift of the Holy Spirit can be imparted by prayer and laying on of hands. And that's consistent in Scripture. Doesn't have to happen that way, does it? How many of you were baptized in the Holy Spirit and nobody laid hands on you? I've got my hand up. Actually, I've shared my testimony before. The night before I received at a revival service with the Prebles, who were singing Southern Gospel group, and they preached as well at the revival, like a three-night revival at our church in Nashville, New Hampshire. It was the night before my 14th birthday. And I went forward because they called people forward, especially the young people. The youth group at our church was almost 80 kids at that time. We were seeing a revival in our youth group. It started in our youth group. And I was 13, getting ready to be 14. And I went forward. I wanted the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I could feel the Holy Spirit drawing me. Yes, this is something you need. And I went forward, and they laid hands on me. I'm telling you, the whole church shook you and said, receive it, take it. Somebody else would say, let it go. And they would tell you, you've got it. And you're like, well, I don't feel like I got it. We have all those things that we say, and they all did that. But I didn't receive the first night. But then I came back the next night, and they called people forward again that wanted to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I went over to the steps of the altar, and I was praying by myself. And I said, Jesus, if you want to fill me with the Holy Spirit, you can fill me without anybody touching me. I want you to fill me. I want to know it's real. I don't want someone to have to tell me you got it. I want to know because I don't want to fake it. I'm the type of person, if the people who fall out, falling out is real. You know, when a preacher prays for you, the power of God comes on you. We call it being slain in the spirit. That's real. But I'm one of those skeptics, all right? Even I'm telling you as a pastor even. I'm a skeptic. If I'm going to fall out, I want it to be the Lord. You're not going to push me over, right? And I was the same way with receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And right there in that corner of the altar on the steps, praying by myself, praying for a long time, but the Lord baptized me with the Holy Spirit, the evidence of speaking in other tongues. So laying on of hands is something that is a practice in Scripture, but it doesn't have to be that way. Jesus is the baptizer. So all you have to do is have him fill you, and you can be filled, all right? This does not mean that this is the only way to receive, for no hands were laid on men at Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, or at the house of Cornelius in Acts chapter 10. So those are scriptural proofs that it doesn't have to be the laying on of hands. Others beside the 12 apostles can lay hands on believers to receive the Spirit in this manner. Acts chapter 9, Acts chapter 19, 1 Timothy 4 and 2 Timothy 1 are all examples of that. So you have been given the authority in Jesus Christ if you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit. So when we have services like we have last Sunday morning, it doesn't just have to be Pastor Eric. If you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit and you don't need to refill yourself, which sometimes we do, then you go forward and pray for somebody. You can lay hands on somebody and the Lord can use you to help somebody receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And that's scriptural. All right, it's biblical to hold special services for this reception of the Holy Spirit. And there's some references for that. It's sad that a lot of Pentecostal so-called denominations in our country are seeing less than 2% of their adherents actually receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And the biggest reason why they're not is because they're not preaching and they're not teaching about it. If you don't preach and you don't teach, then how can people receive? And a lot of people need to be taught, especially the teaching part, because they don't come from a Pentecostal background. They don't come, they weren't raised in a Pentecostal church, and so they need to understand it's not something they have to be afraid of. This is what's going to happen, and know what to expect. And if we're not preaching and teaching it as Pentecostal churches, then we can't expect people to get filled. Amen? And we're going to keep preaching it. We're going to keep teaching it because it's something that is so essential in the life of a believer. Amen? And we should rejoice in the fact that God uses people in this church and the gifts of the Spirit. That there's been people recently filled and refilled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and that's something that should be a normal occurrence in the modern church. All right? It was the gift of God, which is also called the Spirit's baptism. All right? And also referred to the promise of the Father in Luke 24. So there's lots of different references to this second work of grace. It's labeled a couple of different ways, but it's for every believer to receive. And you can see that the apostles were constantly telling people, you need to get saved, but then you need to be filled with the Spirit as well and seek that gift. All right, the phrase, and they receive the Holy Spirit, proclaims the greatest gift any believer can receive. Even a salvation is the greatest gift that a sinner can receive. All right? Thank God he rescued us from our sins. Amen? That was the best day of our life when Jesus turned things around for us. And we came into covenant love relationship with him. We were no longer slaves to sin, but we became slaves to Jesus Christ, slaves to righteousness. But the greatest day for the believer after that is when he fills you with the Holy Spirit. And it's not an arrival point where you say, oh, I've made it. I spoke in tongues. It's the doorway to God using you in ways you never imagined. To preach the gospel, to be used in the gifts of the Spirit, to make a difference in other people. The gospel's not me-centered, it's church-centered, it's greater good-centered. When you get filled with the Holy Spirit, it's not just going to bless you. You're going to get the Holy Ghost goosebumps on the back of your neck, and you're going to go, man, God was in that service. And you should enjoy that. You should. And I think that's what we were feeling Sunday morning, right? God, you're moving in this place. And we've had that in several services. But it's not just me-centered. It's he's filling you for service. So you can go out and build up your brother and sister in Christ. So that you can go out and have an anointing, a power of the Holy Spirit, to deal with some people in your neighborhood, some people on your job, some people in the marketplace who don't know that they need God, but God gives you the boldness to be able to share with them. And so it's not just me-centered, the power of the Holy Spirit and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's for the greater good, so the church can be edified, so that God's harvest can be brought in. We need the Holy Spirit for that to happen. All right, three hindrances can keep one from being baptized in the Holy Spirit. Number one is unbelief. The Christian must lay aside all unbelieving notions received from unbelieving preachers or others, and allow the Word of God to serve as the sole criteria. We must never forget that it is not what man says, but it is what the Word of God declares. To be sure, the Word of God is replete with the guarantee of the promise of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says it's a down payment of what the Shekinah glory of God is going to be like when we get to heaven. Are you excited about that time when we're going to not just have the down payment, but we're going to have the full payment? We're going to be able to see God and the beauty of His holiness and the splendor of His majesty because we'll be in a glorified body and we can handle it then. But for now, God's given us a down payment of what His fullness, His presence is going to be like when we get to heaven. And we should seek the Lord for that. Number two, a hindrance from being baptized in the Holy Spirit, unbelief, number one. Number two, yielding. Instead of holding back, the believer ought to yield to the moving and operation of the Holy Spirit. And the purpose of that, yielding, is so the Spirit of God can have His way in one's life. This bubbling up within one's heart or an expression of release from one's very being is documented by Christ when He spoke of rivers of living water springing up out of the belly, or more perfectly, out of one's being. And that's the Holy Spirit. That's what the Scripture describes the feeling being as. It's like rivers of living water coming out from the inside of you. All right, and the third hindrance is pride. Pride is a very big factor. One must understand that the ways of the world are definitely not the ways of God. To be sure, those His ways are the ways we should seek, for irrespective of what the world may think. And pride, I'm not gonna get up there and dance around like that person does when the Holy Spirit hits them. You better be careful when you say that too, because God has a sense of humor, is what I found. I would never do that. Well, when the Holy Spirit comes on you, it's not about you making a show or you acting in a particular way, but the Holy Spirit, when you're fully yielded to Him, the power of God comes through. I've told you before, when the Spirit of God moves on me, before I was even baptized in the Holy Spirit, I remember youth conventions when I was 12 and 13, before I was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and I would go forward in the altar, and the Spirit of God was moving, and people around me were getting baptized in the Holy Spirit. I wasn't even ready for it. I wasn't even seeking it. But what I would do is I'd just weep. I would just cry. And I'm going, I didn't even understand what I was crying about. People would come up and ask me, "Are you okay?" I'm like, "Yeah." But I'm just weeping. And that's how I responded when the Holy Spirit would move upon me. And each person's different. Some people dance and run and shout. Some people shake and some people cry. And all those are expressions of our frail human body responding to the power of God coming and filling us. And so we need to allow the Holy Spirit, when we yield to Him, to express Himself. Don't say, "I'd never do that." Say, "Holy Spirit, whatever you want to do in me, I relinquish control." Amen. I'm not worried about embarrassing myself, because I know, Holy Spirit, you would never embarrass me. You're for the greater good. You're wanting to form Christ in me. And so I'm completely yielded to whatever you want to do. All right. Whether the external signs which accompanied the gift of the Spirit on this occasion were identical with the Pentecostal signs or not, they were at any rate of so impressive a nature that Simon Magus craved the power to reproduce them at will. So obviously there was some kind of demonstration of power, because Simon the sorcerer says, "I want that. I want to be able to do what these apostles are doing." And he had grown up in a background of sorcery, being able to cast spells and dabble in demonic power. But this was something totally different. He didn't understand it. He spoke in ignorance of things he probably shouldn't have said. And God was patient to use the apostles to teach him. But he wanted to buy this power. So obviously there was something on the outside that was going on that he witnessed. Peter and John were not imparting the Holy Spirit to these people. That sole authority is held by Jesus Christ alone. Matthew 3:11. They, in effect, as all others of similar effort, were simply His hands extended. And that's you. Amen? It's not just the pastor. You can be God's hands extended to see someone filled with the Holy Spirit. Just like you can see somebody saved that maybe I'll never meet as your pastor. They're in your sphere of influence. And it used to be back when my grandparents went to church in the tent revival days, late 60s, that the church's mindset was, we got to get people to church so they can get saved. Well, we live in 2023. We better not expect that the only place people can get saved is in here. Amen? It's so much better for us to get them saved right where they are and then let them come here and just rejoice at what God's already done. It's not just the pastor or the church leading people to Christ. Each believer can do that, and it's the same with the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit baptism doesn't just have to happen in these four walls. The gifts of the Spirit don't just have to operate within these four walls. God can use them outside this building, among the lost. They may not understand what's going on, but it says in 1 Corinthians 14 that the gifts of the Spirit are a sign to the unbeliever. They're like a neon sign saying something supernatural is going on here, and they don't understand it, but that's our opportunity as a believer to say, this is what's going on. This is the Spirit of God, and He wants to get a hold of your life. And so it's not just within the church, it's outside in the world as well. It should be very clear that even though the Lord definitely does use the laying on of hands, the Holy Spirit is not confined to this for people to be healed, delivered, or baptized in the Holy Spirit. And we know the centurion, remember, that went to Jesus and said, "I understand authority. I have men under me, and I understand the authority you have." God had showed that centurion the authority that Jesus had. Amen. Amen? Supernaturally, I believe. Right. Given him a revelation of the authority that Jesus had that was different than any authority this centurion had ever seen. He says, "All you have to do is speak the word, and my servant can be healed." You don't have to come to my house. Just speak the word. And we need to have that kind of fierce faith as well. If a Roman centurion can have that kind of faith,
that's right.
You know, we should have even greater faith, amen, to believe the Lord. Even if we don't have someone to lay hands on us, God can lay hands on you, amen? And you can be baptized, you can be healed, you can be delivered. His idea that God's free gift could be bought, talking about Simon the sorcerer, showed that he had no appreciation at all of the inward character of the gospel and the operation of the Spirit. He was not in the right place when he utters these words. He utters these words in ignorance, and you notice God doesn't throw a lightning bolt at him and kill him. He gives him an opportunity to repent, gives him an opportunity to be taught. And so that's a lesson for us. Somebody read Isaiah 55 and verse 1 for us. Isaiah 55 and verse 1. All right. So God's saying that his gospel is a free gospel. The things he has for us cannot be purchased with money. Simon the sorcerer, that was foreign to him. He made his living by practicing magic arts, sorcery. And so he thought for sure that that's what the disciples did, but he was wrong. And but the things that God has for us, they can't be purchased with money. They're not things that can be bought. Yet, sad to say, much of the modern church world revolves around money instead of the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God can equip us as believers with everything that we need for life and godliness. If we're looking to Jesus, if we're looking to the cross, we're trusting his finished work, then the Holy Spirit has the freedom. He has the ability to come in and do what we cannot do in our own strength. He can bless you beyond measure. Deuteronomy 28, kind of blessing. Where his blessings are chasing you down and overtaking you. They're so good. That's what the Holy Spirit wants to do. But that can't be purchased with money. It's a matter of us just yielding to what God wants to do. Thousands of preachers are afraid to preach what they know the truth to be for fear they will upset people in their church who give large sums of money, etc. Consequently, they have become hirelings. We need less hirelings and more God-called men and women who are in the fivefold ministry, who understand that God is their provider. God is their source. And if you're a watchman on the wall, and you're not saying that the enemy is coming, you're not telling your congregation that the enemy is coming, and that these are his schemes because God's shown the watchman on the wall what those schemes are, you shouldn't be in ministry. You should be, that's a hireling. Person who God has called and set as a watchman on the wall, they will say what thus saith the Lord, no matter what the consequences. And we need more men and women of God who get on their faces, who don't go on SermonCentral.com and download 6 outlines for their messages for the month and all the illustrations and points. No, we need to hear from God. We need to say, God, show me what you're saying right now for your people that you've put me over, whether you're a pastor, a teacher, evangelist, a missionary, a prophet, apostle, any of the fivefold ministry. We need people who hear from God.
Amen.
Who have a thus saith the Lord, an anointing of the Holy Spirit. And we better be looking for that. All right. What constitutes the heart not being right with God, at least as it refers to believers? It can be summed up in this fashion. Anything and everything that is not exactly according to the Word of God and the leading and the administration of the Holy Spirit must of necessity be of man. Consequently, it is not of God, and therefore pertains to self-will, which means the heart is not right. Simon thought, he had an idea, but his light bulb moment wasn't a God light bulb moment.
Right.
He had his own plan, and what he was desiring was flesh. It was self, and it would bring destruction to him if he wasn't careful. And so we can learn from that. Isaiah chapter 5. In verse 20. Someone want to read that for us nice and loud? Isaiah 5 and verse 20.
Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter.
All right. And there's a verse in the last verse, and I think it's 1 Kings. where it says almost the same thing. The people called good evil and evil good. They did what was right in their own eyes. We're living in a generation that's doing that right now, aren't we? Our own country that was founded upon Christianity and godly principles, we've turned to calling what's good evil and what's evil good, doing what's right in our own eyes. And God help us. We as the church better be crying out for God's mercy. Have mercy on us. Help us to understand the difference between the holy and the profane. Because there's your loved ones, there's your friends, there's your family members who are hanging in the balance that need to have a salvation experience with Christ. Amen? And if we don't make the distinction, they're going to be lost. And so same was going on in the book of Acts. Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. Can someone read that for us? Matthew 7, verses 21 through 23. Go ahead, Juliana.
Not everyone who calls out to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of my Father in heaven will enter. On judgment day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and performed many miracles in your name. But I will reply, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's laws.
All right. Powerful stuff there that Jesus is saying, right? It's not just association that makes us Christian. Not because you hang out with a bunch of Christians that you're a Christian, any more than you're a car because you're hanging out in a garage, right? Or you're a chicken because you're hanging out on the farm. It's not association. It's, do you have Jesus in your heart? Has he changed you from the inside out? Is there evidence of his Holy Spirit moving and flowing and working in your life? And we can have the Christian t-shirts and the Christian bumper stickers and the association, but when the rapture takes place, how many people in the church may be left behind because they don't really know the Lord? The Lord really knows those who are his, the Bible says. And if we don't belong to him, every part, God wants every part, amen? If we don't have our hearts completely surrendered to him, we may hear at judgment day, I never knew you. What a horrible, awful thing to hear, especially if you think you're saved, to not hear, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of my kingdom, to hear instead, depart from me, I never knew you. You had motions that you went through, you had activity, religious activity, but I never knew you. What a horrible thing. And so that's what Simon is being warned about here, right? Not just having association. He wanted to associate with the apostles. And he wanted people to be enamored by him, but the disciples told him, and God used them to tell him, that's not what it's about. It's not about association. It's about Jesus being in control of your life and him accomplishing his purposes in and through you in the power of the Holy Spirit. The Lord always looks at the heart in such circumstances. Actually, this is of far greater significance than the act of sin committed itself. In other words, the state of the heart determines the gravity of the offense. Okay, and Simon's probably saying what he says mostly in ignorance. Thankful, aren't you thankful God forgives us when we do things that we didn't know? But he teaches us. He's patient with us. He's a good heavenly Father. And he wants what's best for us. And that word jealous, when it says God is jealous for you, do you know that? He's jealous for you. The Bible says that in many places. And we have a connotation of jealousy that's MTV driven or Hollywood driven, movie driven, right? We think of jealousy as, you know, two girls fighting over a guy and they're jealous or something like that, right? God's jealous, meaning he wants what's best for you. Right. He has enough concern for your well-being. He doesn't want to allow anything to steal the promises, the blessings, the treasures that he has in store for you. He's jealous of you having his best. And so we need to understand godly jealousy. He's jealous of each one of us. He doesn't want Satan to have his way. He doesn't want anything but what he's destined for your life to come to pass. It says he's written every one of your days in his books before one of them came to be. Isn't that awesome? Psalm 139. He's written our lives in his books. And I believe when we get to heaven, the book of life will be open. The Bible will be opened, I believe. There's books where God has written down things about your life, you specifically, that may be different than anybody else in this room. God's going to open those books and say, this is what I destined for you. This is what you walked into. This is what you missed. Before he wipes away all tears from our eyes, we're going to see some things that we missed that he had in store for us because he's jealous for us, but that we missed. And we need to say, God, I don't want to miss one blessing. Amen. I don't want to miss one treasure, one promise that you have for my life. Parents, I don't want my kids to miss one blessing, one treasure, one step that God has ordained, that he's written in his books for their life. I want them to walk into every one of them. Amen. You ought to pray that over your kids and over your grandkids, because that's what God wants. He's jealous of his people. He wants what's best for his people. All right. Many stories have sprung up respecting Simon in later years. However, we are given nothing biblical regarding this man after his request for prayer. Whether he continued to follow the Lord, getting victory over these things, or fell back into the old bondage is not known from Scripture. All right. Simon's response indicates he was more concerned about the consequences of his evil than about real repentance. And so it's kind of just left open-ended in Acts chapter 8. He is, of course, warned that what he's doing is not right, and has an opportunity, just like Cain in Genesis chapter 4. God asked Cain about 13 questions when Abel had been killed. And God knew the answer to every one of those questions, didn't he? He was asking the questions. He was allowing time on Cain's part for him to repent, right? To get things right. And I believe the same thing was true with Simon. We don't know the outcome. Maybe one day when we get to heaven, we'll know the outcome of that. But God does not play with sin. He does not. His power cannot be bought. It's something that we ought to reverence, that we ought to understand. And what is holy should not be mixed up with what is common or profane. And we've got to be careful of that. And we can see the lessons from that in the story of Simon. We'll stop there for tonight.